So that's about tension test. I encourage all of you to actually read the chapter on the tension test from the textbook of Deiter, Mechanical Metallurgy by George E. Deiter. So it, at the end of these slides, you have the name of the textbook. There is a chapter exclusively on, the chapter name itself is the tension test. Okay, you get lots of information, insight into the reason why these curves are the way that they are, right? So all the discussion that we had in the class, you can reinforce by reading that chapter. It's about 30 to 40 pages, but it's really a worth reading. All right, so then the next property, hardness, and how do we go about measuring hardness? So there are several definitions available in the literature for hardness, and hence it is quite ambiguous, right? People define hardness as resistance to deformation, some people define as resistance to permanent deformation for metals, and some people define it as resistance to indentation, and somebody says that the quantity is that hardness is a quantity that describes strength and heat treatment. So which one to follow, you don't know, right? So because there is a lot of ambiguity, in this class we will try to fix to one definition that is more suitable for mechanical engineers. Okay, so the definition that is more suitable for us is indentation hardness. If you are talking to a mineralogist who is looking at minerals and rocks and so on, for him or her, the type of hardness is scratch hardness. What do you do? Scratch hardness means you take a sample, scratch it. If you are able to dislodge the material, then it is softer. If you are not able to dislodge, then it is harder. Of course, you don't do with hand, but they will have some technique to actually dislodge the material. But essentially, that's what they do. And for that, that is a reasonable way to look at hardness for mineralogists. Okay, and for us, indentation hardness. That means you take a material and then you indent using a indenter, and then you look at the depth, indentation depth, and if it is a hard material, your indentation depth is going to be small, and if it is soft material, your indentation depth is going to be hard. That is something that we can relate to even without doing an experiment, right? If you take a sponge and if you take a rock, obviously if you indent, the sponge goes in, so that means the depth of indentation is increasing for soft materials. And for some people, it can be rebound or dynamic hardness. You take a ball, drop it on a surface, and the height to which it rebounds tells you the hardness of the surface or the ball, right? It's like a coefficient of restitution that you probably have studied, right? So if it is a very soft material, the coefficient of restitution is going to be higher or lower. So if you take a ball, right, and bump it on a concrete surface, vis-a-vis put the concrete, put a mat on a concrete surface and drop it, you will see the rebound distances are different, right? That is also another measure of hardness. But in this class, let us restrict to indentation hardness, okay? So there are different kinds of tests one can do in order to measure hardness through indentation. The one of the earlier methods is what is called Brinell hardness. It is proposed by a person called J.A. Brinell. Okay, so there are some standards, like tension test, uniaxial tension test has some standards, right? You have to have your specimen of certain dimensions and so on, and if you want to change the dimensions, you cannot change the way that you want. You have to maintain some similitude so that your results can be correlated, right? So the geometric similitude is important even when you are doing uniaxial tension test, and if you want to change your dimensions from the regular dimensions. Now that is something, that information you can find out from the Deiter's textbook that I have suggested, okay? All right, so how do you go about doing this test? You use an indenter, and then using that indenter, you actually apply a load onto the surface and see what is the depth of the indentation. And depending on the shape of the indenter, you will have different tests. A Brinell hardness test uses a spherical indenter, a spherical ball, a steel ball as an indenter. So this diagram, the schematic represents. So this blue color one is your indenter, and the bottom one, this guy, is your material that needs to be tested for its hardness. And then you apply a load P, and then measure what is the indentation depth, right? So this is the diameter of the circle that you would create on the surface, equivalent to the indentation area, right? So the procedure is, you indent the metal surface with a 10 mm diameter steel ball. This is the standard. The diameter of the steel ball is 10 mm for Brinell hardness. But if you want to change, you can change by following certain rules, okay? And if it is a hard metal, you apply a load of 3000 kg. And if it is a soft metal, you apply a load of 500 kg. You decide what load you want to apply. If the material is extremely hard, first of all, with respect to the material, the indenter has to be stiffer, right? By applying the load, indenter should not deform. You are trying to measure the hardness of the surface. And hence, if you are going to measure extremely hard surfaces, then steel may not be the right choice. Then in those cases, you will use tungsten carbide, right? If you are intending to measure hardness of surfaces which are harder than tungsten carbide, probably you might want to use some other procedure, okay? All right, so for very hard materials or metals, tungsten carbide ball is used instead of steel ball. And typically the load is applied for a standard time. The time is usually 30 seconds. You apply only for 30 seconds. Beyond that, you don't apply any load. And then after 30 seconds, you see what is the load. And then usually this load is applied not suddenly, so gradually, and then hold at that particular load for 30 seconds. That's what we mean. And the Brinell hardness number, that is the number that represents the hardness of this material, is some sort of stress measure, right? Load by some area, right? So this is the Brinell hardness number formula. And then if you know this angle phi, then you know, if you know the diameter, so this is how you calculate the Brinell hardness number, and where P is the load applied in kgf, D is the diameter in mm. That is important, okay? This formula, when you are getting the Brinell hardness number, you are applying load in kg force, D is the diameter in mm, small d is the average diameter of the indentation, T is the depth of indentation. You can measure the depth of indentation, that is what you have, okay? And now, if you want to use non-standard indenter size, you don't have 10 mm ball, but you have say 5 mm ball. With the 10 mm ball, what is the load that we have to apply? 3000 kg. So you just need to ensure, if you are changing the ball size, you also have to change the load that you want to apply according to this similitude formula. So if you change your D1, so let's say D1 is 10, then P1 is 3000. If you want D2 to be 5, then accordingly you have to change your P2 as well. That P1 by D1 square and P2 by D2 square is what you need to maintain constant, because the Brinell hardness number is proportional to that. Okay? And of course, that is true when you are trying to make these two P's constant. That means you are getting the geometric similitude. And by measuring the Brinell hardness, you can also sort of estimate the tensile strength of the material. It's only an empirical formula suitable only for plain carbon and medium elastics. That means, if you know your Brinell hardness number in kgf per mm square from the previous formula, if you multiply that with 3.4, the number that you get is the ultimate strength of the steel in MPa. So if your Brinell hardness number is, let us say 70, 200 is too much. So let us say, not too much. Let us say it is 200, then 3.4 times 200 kgf per mm square. This should be in that unit, that is important. Then that is, how much it is? 680, right? 680 MPa. Then the ultimate strength of that particular material is 680 MPa. So the this is an empirical formula, and hence please don't see the balance of units. The empirical formula work like that, right? Because on one side you have kgf per mm square, on the other side you have megapascals, right? One is the metric system, actually not complete metric system, that is also a weird system, right? Kg force and millimeters, they don't really go well, but that's how the standards have been developed, and we are still sticking to that standard. Okay, all right. Now that is Brinell hardness. If you change the indenter from steel ball to something else, some other indenter shape, and that if that indenter shape happens to be 120 degrees diamond cone or sometimes spherical ball, then you will have something called Rockwell hardness test. Okay, how does this guy work? You apply a constant load and measure the depth of indentation. Okay, that is the measure of your hardness as usual. But how the test is to be done? In this case, first you apply a minor load of 10 kg. You take the specimen and the indenter. First you apply a minor load of 10 kg just to prepare the specimen for the test, because there may be some surface scales and all, so you want to get rid of them. So this 10 kg is used to get rid of these surface scales, and you want to really measure the hardness of the real surface. And then once after applying this 10 kg minor load, then you apply the major load, and the depth of indentation is measured on a dial. So you have something like that with a dial gauge, and here you have in your indenter, and then you have specimen, and then you press it, and then you measure the depth by this dial gauge. Okay, this dial contains 100 divisions. Each division represents 0.002 mm penetration. Unlike, we will also talk about Vickers test, but unlike Brinell and Vickers, the Rockwell hardness numbers are, they don't have a unit. What is the unit of Brinell hardness number? Kgf per mm square. Whereas Rockwell hardness number is just only a number. They are arbitrary, there is no unit. So Rockwell hardness number, you will not report 0.002 mm, but you will report what is the scale, the dial representing, what number the dial is representing on the scale, right? So we said major load has to be applied, right? First a minor load of 10 kg and then a major load. The major load, what is the major load? It can be 60, 100 or 150, one of them, depending on the material. If it is a soft material, you will live with 60, little bit hard, 100, much harder, 150. Okay? But Rockwell hardness test is primarily mainly done with 120 degree diamond cone, or sometimes you can also use spherical ball. So this is how you will apply. You apply a minor load and then major load, and then remove the major load, and then you measure the depth of indentation. And that depth of indentation is shown on the dial. All right. So the Rockwell, different scales are available. So depending upon which scale are you using, you have to mention Rockwell A, Rockwell B, Rockwell C, D, E, F, G. So Rockwell hardness on scale A, what is the meaning of that? If you are saying that my HRA is some number, that means I am using a 120 degree diamond cone indenter, and the load is 60 kgf. That is the meaning of Rockwell scale A. If I say Rockwell scale C, that means I am applying a load of 150 kg force and 120 degree diamond cone is my specimen. Okay, like that. So there are different scales that are defined just to represent what is my geometry of the indenter and what is the load that I am applying. So whenever you are reporting the hardness number from Rockwell hardness test, you have to report what kind of scale have you used. Is it HRC, HRB or HRA? And unfortunately, you cannot write a direct correlation from Rockwell to Brinell. You don't have an empirical formula that relates Rockwell to Brinell, okay? All right, so the way that Rockwell hardness number is calculated, with this RHN equal to 100 minus H by 0.1 over 2 for n diamond cone of a spherical ball. This is how Rockwell hardness number is represented. So the typical way that you would, if you are looking into standards, the way that you will see hardness number to be HRC 55 to 66. It's actually a hardened, so the hardness is relatively higher. That's what we mean by this, right? HRC 55 to 66 is the Rockwell hardness number for high carbon steel. For brass, it is HRB. Please see the pay attention. Both of them are giving you almost same dial scale, but this is C and that is B. So what is C and B? Go back. B is only having 100 kg force, whereas C is having 150 kg force. And this specimen, the indentary steel sphere, and here it is 120 degree diamond cone. And hence HRC 55 is actually more severe indentation depth than HRB 55. Can you see that? And that is the reason why you need to specify what is my scale. So that is why you can say that this is actually harder than this scale. Is that clear? Okay. So HRCW, if you say HRC, that means my indentary is a steel ball. If I am putting HRCW 60, that means my indenter is not steel but tungsten carbide. The W represents the material of the indenter. Okay? Any questions? There cannot be any questions here. Yeah. It's only an information. Just to remember, you don't have to remember the numbers. Okay? You just need to remember how the designation is made. If I say HRCW 60, then you should be able to say that it is, the indenter is a tungsten carbide indenter, not a steel indenter, and it is not a spherical indenter, it is a 120 degree diamond cone indenter. This is diamond pyramid. Okay, the indenter is different in the Vickers hardness test, and the way the Vickers hardness test works is similar to Brinell hardness test. It also reports the load by area, unlike Rockwell hardness. Okay, so many times you might actually you will do an experiment in ME lab next semester. There you will measure hardness of a surface using Vickers hardness test. Okay, so then you need to know the geometry, and then from the geometry you will be able to calculate what is the hardness number of the hardness value of this material. We in the lab we have the Vickers hardness test, and if somebody else comes up with something else and which is better than these things, probably that hardness test come in. There is no, this is something that people have evolved over the years, and you know the numbers now, right? If you go to a catalog and you have, you know the numbers, and then you say that okay, my hardness is this. And if you want to come up with your own standard, welcome, but make sure that world is okay with that as well, right? That's how these standards work. Rockwell A to Rockwell B, you mean? It is relative because the first of all the indenter shapes are different. So the fact that the indenter shape is different, the local stress state is going to be completely different, right? If you are taking a material and if you are using this kind of an indenter vis-a-vis this kind of an indenter, the local state of stress below the indenter is going to be very different, right? The stress state is going to be much more severe in this case compared to here, and so on. So it is, to my knowledge, I don't think we have any direct correlations from one scale to another scale, but you can sort of make an assessment that okay, if I, the way that you need to do is you need to do the tests on the same material using Rockwell A and Rockwell B, C, D, and then try to see an empirical form. In principle one can do that. I don't know if such things exist. Maybe they are there, but to my knowledge I don't know if they exist. Okay. you can actually go back and verify. It's a good exercise. All right, any other questions? Good. So this is the textbook that I was referring to. You have to read the chapter, the tension test. All right, so with that we close mechanical properties. You have any questions?